Welcome to Subramani. This is going to be a pretty long video, a little organized and a little unorganized, so there'll be some kind of rambling. So these are my lessons from equity, and I will be doing very many such videos. It's not that there is one video which will cover all my learnings, right? And I may not be able to summarize everything in one video. So one thing, and these are numbered, let's say number one for me has been diversify your portfolio. Okay, what I mean by diversifying, I mean across groups. So you have to have your Tata Group, Mittla Group, your Murugappa Group, your MNC groups. American MNCs are the ones which have largely made money for you. The Italian companies have never made money, whether it's a Lamborghini came to India, didn't make money for you, like, you know. So you have to be very careful what kind of a JV it is. Companies in US have very high level of disclosure, so they are worried about what will happen to their listing there. So these companies are better. Korean companies listed, you can't find too many. Japanese companies like Toyota are not listed. So largely you're talking of American companies, German companies. Siemens has made money, Cummins is an American company. So look at the industry, look at the country from where they are, the MNCs depends on that. So diversify across this. Diversify across geography. So it can't happen that all your companies are based in Mumbai, all your companies are based in Chennai. But largely, if you see, prosperity is in a very small belt in India. One or two companies, like if it's an MNC, don't matter. It doesn't matter whether it is located in Delhi or even in Calcutta. ITC for a long time used to be called an MNC because BAT used to own 30%. I don't think BAT owns that. Maybe BAT has sold off. I really don't know what is the position, but I can't see BAT as a shareholder. So look at all those diversification across, like I said, across groups, across industries. So you have to have some, if you have metals, you're likely to have Hindalco or Tata Steel, JSW, and even a Vedanta. Diversify across good management and not so good management. Don't wait for every company to have the same corporate governance standards like the best. They don't have. Indian companies' corporate governance is very poor. If you draw the line very high, none will qualify, not even the Tatas, right? Not even the Sundaram and the Murugappa group will quantify if you see how some of the management, the owners, how they behave, right? So some of the times you feel angry that, but then these are the gold standards. So the others are below them. So it doesn't really matter. Be careful that they just check whether they leave enough on the table for you to eat. There are companies which have been bad in governance which suddenly turn out to be good, right? So then you say, oh, now this company is worth following. Reliance went through that phase. It was not a very trustworthy company till global scrutiny started. That must have been sometime in 1981-82. After that, their standards definitely improved. But still, it's a very confusing balance sheet. You have to go by hunch and P and those things for Reliance rather than saying, I understand the balance sheet. I'm yet to find somebody who understands the Reliance balance sheet, but then I'm yet to find somebody who understands the Citibank balance sheet. So I'm not talking of very high standards or low standards, but yes, diversify across. And also, now the other diversification is diversified across what I would call growth investing, value investing, dividend based investing. You can have all separately. You have to know why you are buying a share, right? So there is nothing wrong. You can do, at least I do deep value investing. I do very, very deep value investing. I do momentum trading. So I could be buying in the morning, selling in the evening, just because there is a huge price movement. No other reason. I bought it for the long term, but suddenly I found 6% jump or an 8% jump within a week, 10% jump within a week. To me, that is great, simply because 5% is a GSEC yield and 10% if I can get in a week. I got my annual debt yield multiplied by 2. To me, that's more than sufficient enough a reason to sell, right? So don't get into a trap saying, oh, but Subra, you're a value investor, you shouldn't be buying. Don't get into that bullshit trap. That is for fund managers to worry. And the best of people can do harm to your portfolio, and the worst of people can be good with your portfolio. So I know one of the most notorious Indian scamsters. His younger brother introduced me to PSU investing, and I owe a limb to him in terms of investing. It doesn't mean, it also means that the debt fund manager can make, give you very good calls on strategy, even on equity. One of India's best fund managers is a very good business fund manager, rather than just a, we consider him to be a great, like he says, Bhagwan bana ke rakha hai, equity fund manager, but his calls on debt market go bang on, right? But he will never give it in a public place. So don't get trapped into believing, oh, this guy knows only equity, this guy knows only debt. Not true. These guys know the business. They know it inside out. They know attitude. They know fund, they know promoter psychology. They know all those things. It is just that right now they are dealing in an instrument called equity. And a person who can understand equity can understand debt perfectly well. He may get it wrong with the debt cycle, but he will not get it wrong with the business cycle, and business cycle is far more difficult to handle, right? So don't worry about those things. Don't overpay for a stock. You will never regret not buying Reliance today at say 2500 or 2300, whatever is the price, because it's not really cheap. So you will get your chance in the next 2 years, 3 years, 5 years to be able to buy Reliance. When you get the chance, take it. We are not in the market today where you will regret that you didn't invest. Yes, market could go up higher, but it is not a market which you will turn back after 5 years and say, I wish I had bought it in 2020 September. No, we are not at that kind of valuation in most of the shares, right? And like one, I don't want to name any fund manager, but like a fund manager says, India mein kabhi teji mandi nahi hota. This is such a beautiful statement, because right at the peak boom of an infrastructure boom, I would call the 2003 to 2007 the infrastructure boom, because it was those shares like your Larsen & Toubro and Tata Power and your banking, your Cholamandalam, HDFC and Kotak Bank. These are the shares which had moved up dramatically, right? Pharma had not moved up, FMCG had not moved up. So even at that time, you could have bought those shares and still made money. Or you could have bought all these shares like FMCG and Pharma in 2003 and completely not participated in the 2003 to 2007 bull run. Both were possible, right? So don't worry too much about cycles. If you're doing a bottom-up approach, perfectly all right. When you buy a good share, that's a good time to buy. Like today, if you are not buying an Apple at this kind of valuation, it won't really, I don't think it will hurt in your whole life portfolio. Yes, your Apple or a Reliance could go higher, much higher. I'm not talking about that, but it will not matter to your portfolio that you did not buy it, because you would have bought something else at a lower valuation. So why, what stops you from buying a good PSU today at 8% dividend yield valuation instead of a Reliance at this price, where it is definitely not a dividend yield candidate? So next 3, 4, 5 years, you could make more money in that stock than you could perhaps make in Reliance. So don't get worried, don't get carried away, and don't overpay. Do not buy a stock just because everybody is buying. If it fits into your dividend profile, buy it in your dividend profile. If it fits into your growth profile, buy it into your growth profile. And while tabulating it, keep them separate. You know why you bought it, you know why you want to sell it. So write a small 40 word story on why you're buying it. This is not your, you're not making a trustee report, but you're just making a note for yourself saying why you're buying it, right? Be careful about costs. So, but keep it in a very careful play. I mean, I would keep my equities only with HDFC Bank, Stockholding Corporation, ICICI Bank, kind of places, and I will not leave it with my broker. It is too risky. Why can't you see that? Why can't you see what is happening in Anugrah stock brokers? Why can't you see what happened to your money in Karvi, right? I have no clue whether people in Karvi have retrieved their money. Many people have not. They are still waiting, right? So some people were lucky, some people were unlucky. Anugrah, I have no clue whether anybody is going to get paid, and if they are going to get paid, how much they are going to get paid, right? So there is no clarity regarding these things. The chances are they may get nothing, right? So be very careful. Do not leave it around freely. I mean, after all the research that you do, the effort that you take, the brokerage that you negotiate, you do everything, and just leave it lying open for a burglar to steal it, well, I think that is foolish. Do you have solutions? Yes, stick to good, big, solid banks, demat accounts, keep it there. Yes, it is more expensive, but anyway, I've never bothered about brokerage rates because I'm a very small trader. Yes, I do trade. Yes, it hurts to pay a higher broker. But the reason why I would keep it in a big bank is simply because the safety of my money is far more important than the brokerage that I can save. The brokerage I save is a pittance compared to the total net worth of equities that I have. I will not take a chance with that. It is also very important to understand the business into which you are investing. If it's a very complicated business, don't get into it. But if it is a complicated business where you need not get too much into it, for example, Siemens, it makes pretty sophisticated products. But you don't need to get too much into what is the product, how it is used, as long as you know it is a investment, it's a product which is for industrial usage, and when the investments pick up, this share will pick up. It is not a it's not a commodity company. It does not make soap and shampoo. Similarly for Cummins, and similarly you know that these companies will manufacture it in India to export. You know that if Cummins and Siemens have their manufacturing base in China and they want to say, okay, let's get something from India too. So it's fairly obvious that these companies, the Indian subsidiaries, may not have to work too hard to get business which will take them to China or Europe or even US, right? So those are the advantages. So as long as you know that much, life is fine. Be very clear that your equity money is not available to you for 10 years at least. Assume that. But the dividend money is available, and dividend is a constant reminder to you that you have done a good job, and there is money falling into your kitty because you have done a good job in creating a good portfolio, and therefore you are getting the dividend. I have seen people using leverage, and leverage can be, I can either say don't use leverage, so you know, you should not use leverage, but there is another way to use leverage very smartly. Assume for a minute that you can get money at 10% per annum. You have, let's say you have a 8 crore portfolio on which you are getting a 3% dividend yield, so you are getting 24 lakhs as dividend income. But you are a person who is young, who is maybe 45 years of age, and you have a proper job with which to meet your day-to-day expenses, vacations, everything. So you do not really need the dividend. So you go and borrow money. Maybe 2.5 crores is what you borrow. Actually 2 crore 40 lakhs is what you borrow, because the interest on that is 24 lakhs, which is your dividend income. So your dividend income is sufficient to pay off the loan interest. It's not sufficient to pay off the debt, but this is, so what will happen is every year you will have to pay 24 lakhs because you're not repaying the amount, or you're treating the amount like an overdraft. So 24 lakhs will get adjusted against interest, and so the interest is not bothering you. There is cash coming in and there is cash going out. The advantage is the debt is in solid terms. It is not inflation adjusted. So if you take a 1 crore worth of debt, you have to repay 1 crore. In this case, if you have taken 3 crore worth of debt, you will have to pay 3 crores. Now here you have taken the amount of 2.5 crores. You will have to pay 2.5 crores. Today your portfolio is 8 crores. Now, the minute your portfolio goes above 8 crores, you take a portion of it and repay the loan. Suppose it has gone to 8 crore 40 lakhs in 1 year, or it has gone up, say, to 8 crore 80 lakhs or 8 crore 90 lakhs. You say, okay, let me remove 25 lakhs from there and repay the loan. So you repay the loan. So keep down paying the loan, paying the interest completely from the dividends that you receive. If you do these things, this is responsible leveraging. There are people who do it with such strict rules. That's fantastic. However, there would be somebody who would say, I will not do leveraging at all. That's also fine, because I'm a little anti-leveraging and investing. So personally, I wouldn't do it, but I know people who do it so responsibly. So you need to understand there are three options. One is do it. One is don't do it at all. One is to do it responsibly, saying I'm borrowing so much, I'm going to pay so much interest. However, my income from other sources will be able to repay that loan. I will not have to touch my capital. I will not have to touch my current amount of money that I have. So this is a very responsible kind of leveraging. So if you want to leverage, do it responsibly. And That's about it, I think. So, I mean, there will be, of course, take care of the cause, don't make sure that the other family members are not also doing speculation, and you find that you know, you're up, you end up in a bad position. Make sure of all those things, but specifically this much. Thank you.